You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we make our AI create an image from text that you can post to Instagram. We'll show you how to make those discrete steps on the next episode of the AI Show. Make sure to tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show, where I've got a special friend with me, Santosh. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Santosh Pillai. I'm a program manager in the Azure Machine Learning team. I work with the pipelines feature.
Fantastic. So before we get into pipelines, let's talk about like a workflow for a typical machine learning scenario, because I feel like this sets the context for what we're working on. Tell us what a good workflow is for machine learning.
At a high level, a machine learning workflow will have three major phases: the data preparation phase, and the training phase, and the deployment and scoring phase. Mm-hmm. So in the data preparation phase, you have data ingestion, validation, and transformation, etc. In the training phase, you will leverage features like automated machine learning, hyperparameter tuning, and custom model building. Mm-hmm. In the deployment phase, you deploy, score, and monitor your models that are ongoing. But in the overall mature workflow, you will also have retraining as well as batch predictions.
And the thing is, like, if you put this all, and I've done this, people, if you put this all in one script, it takes forever, and then you're like an hour in and something breaks, and that's kind of not a good thing, because then you have to start all over again, and it's not very good.
That's when you break these down into modular chunks, right? You can break it down to phases, like mm-hmm. data preparation could be one phase, mm-hmm. and training would be another phase. You will have different steps for individual phases. You can use pipelines for individual phases, or you can use as an Uber orchestrator for the end-to-end scenario.
So let's talk, you mentioned the word pipelines, and so we talked about the standard machine learning workflow. How do pipelines help with that? Tell us what pipelines are and how they help.
Sure. So even if you are just having a single step to run a single model training, you will start realizing the advantages of using pipelines when you start from exploration to iterations.
I see.
So usually when you need to iterate many times over to perfect your machine learning model. So for example, one of the things is reuse of the steps. A step is a unit of computation. So when you really want to redo the steps over and over again, we have something called reuse of steps. So that means the reuse of computations that are already done. In that case, you are saving a lot of compute cost just by reusing the step. In an enterprise scenario, we are talking about 30% savings on the compute cost.
And that's amazing because, like, I don't know, like when I'm running, here's an example. I do TensorFlow stuff all the time, and I'm a computer vision person, and so what happens is I crunch through all these images, and then the training breaks, and then I have to go and re-crunch through all these images. Oh, if I'm understanding you right, you're telling me I can put the crunching of images into a single step, and that data will just be there unless something changes.
Absolutely. So if the input and parameters of the step remain the same, we are not going to rerun that step unless you specifically want us to tell us to do so.
I see. And that was my next question. Like, how do you know when to run it again? And you're saying that when the input and the parameters are different, then you know you need to run. Otherwise, just reuse that stuff.
Exactly.
That's awesome. And so how does one actually set this up? I mean, you talked about sort of the optimizations and how it's actually pretty powerful, but is it hard to do?
It is not very hard to do. So you can start with Jupyter Notebooks, and you have constructs to build up individual steps in Jupyter Notebooks, or straight up Py files. So once you have finished building a pipeline for an individual phase, you can just publish that pipeline and get a REST endpoint. So what that means is that then the callers or the teams who are using your data processing phase, for example, they can just call into that REST endpoint. They don't need to know the details of the pipeline's building.
I see. So let me see if I understand this right. So if we're putting these pipelines out to a REST endpoint, that means anyone can call them and change the parameters. And if the parameters are changed, then only the steps that need to run are run.
That's exactly right. So if you are authorized to call into that REST endpoint, yes, you can call into the REST endpoint. You don't need to know how it was built and what are the optimizations that went into it. You only need to know what parameters you need to use to run into that workflow.
Okay, so if I'm understanding this right, and then maybe we can get into a little bit what this looks like inside of Azure Machine Learning Service. So basically, whenever you're doing a machine learning process, the first thing I need to do is separate into discrete steps. These steps then I can package into a single like Python file, for example. Then what I do is for each of these steps, I create a set of pipeline things, and then those tasks get run?
Yeah, so a pipeline, the steps can be stitched together using data dependency. So if you say a step is going to produce some data and the subsequent step is going to use that data, it'll all pipelines will automatically figure that out and wait for that step to finish or the data to be available before the next steps happens. So you would construct your steps in such a way that there are certain modular chunks that output a certain data, uh-huh. whether it is a data ingestion data or transformed data,
sure.
or the output of a trained model, which is a model. Then you move on to the next step as to what to do with that output, whether it is a data or a model.
And that's interesting because implicitly what happens is when you build these steps, all of a sudden there's like a graph of things that need to happen, and you're saying that the graph is implicitly constructed by the data dependencies.
Absolutely. Or you can say, like, if there are no data dependency, you can actually force some steps to wait for one of the previous steps to finish.
I see.
So there are other constructs that enable you to do that as well.
So there's implicit graph of tasks, and then there's an explicit one. And what's cool about this is if you have certain ones that have no dependency, if you've set up your compute correctly, these can run on different nodes at the same time.
Correct. By default, all the nodes that have all the dependency satisfied or no dependency will run in parallel.
That's cool.
But you can make them in sequence by explicit constraints.
All right, well, I feel like we need to look at this now.
All right. So here is a graph that actually is built for creating an image mm-hmm. from a poem, and that image gets published into an Instagram post. So that's this graph generates an image, an Instagram post every time the pipeline runs.
Wait, this is crazy. So you're saying that this will actually, from some text, create an image and then put it out onto Instagram.
That's exactly right.
All right, well let's go into the steps because that sounds crazy and I want to see what steps there are to do that.
All right.
Let's go through that.
So here we are looking at the three data sources up on the top mm-hmm. That are the data sources for the creation of the poem first. So it is automatically generated based on the data that we are feeding into.
I see.
Right? And then we are pulling them into the text to image step, mm-hmm. which means that once the data is generated, it is going to generate an image based on the text that is provided.
I see. So I'm looking at these, and there's like little like database looking symbols next to things, and like check marks next to the other. Can you describe the different kinds of steps that exist in a pipeline?
Yeah. So these are called nodes. The top ones are data nodes.
Okay.
So there is no node computation involved. It is pointing to data.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that have check marks are libraries, which we call modules or steps. And they are the green check marks indicate that particular execution of that particular module has finished.
I see. And now this can be used. And now I'm getting a better sense for this. These can be used not just for training, but they can be used for generation, for any series of computation that require like GPU type huge compute. For
exactly. Sure. So for example, in data during data processing, you might be using Spark.
Mm-hmm.
And for training, you might be using CPU or GPU compute cluster in AML compute.
I see.
And for deployment, you could be using ACI or AKS.
Uh-huh.
So pipelines can stitch together these heterogeneous compute options using different frameworks, if you will.
And that's amazing because each of the steps are discrete, and I imagine that the output of each step stores it somewhere so that it knows this is a discrete set of data, and then you can reuse that data everywhere.
That's exactly right. The output is stored into user's data store, uh-huh. where the user can construct a pipeline data object where you can store that into the data store. And our backend knows how to go and fetch that and reuse in the next step. So we'll keep that around for reuse as well for the next pipeline that comes along.
Now, this is amazing. What are the benefits to people that are running business? Why is it such a good business tool, do you think?
Obviously, collaboration is a key, right? For different engineers working on different areas of the machine learning workflow, they can work independently, yet they can stitch together the workflow, the end-to-end scenario in a single pipeline. That also gives an idea about what others are building. So again, people don't have to wait for transferring their data that they produce
right.
into the next person or the model that they produce, the data scientists produce, to ops engineer to actually go and deploy it.
And so everything is all nicely wrapped up into one spot.
Exactly. And businesses obviously care about their cost savings as well. So reuse is a big cost saver. And they can also look at the reports and monitoring that we have and say, okay, well, this particular project doesn't have the ROI that we are expecting, so they can make educated business decisions as well.
Well, this has been amazing. We've learned all about the machine learning workflow. We learned about pipeline steps, how to do stuff in pipelines and separate your stuff out. And then we learned about pipeline data, which actually can be reused, so you don't have to reuse all the compute. And we've learned all about how amazing it is to use Azure Machine Learning Service pipelines. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Seth.
Thanks you so much for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.